I'm going to do a little different video today. Y'all are used to seeing me fix and work on stuff, but I'm just going to show some things. These are kind of some knick-knack things that I got. Maybe useful for some future projects, or may just be something to look at, but I figure I'm going to share them here. The first one, old thermostatic expansion valve. You can see Detroit company. I'm going to put a little stuff on there to help me bring out the highlights. Get a little better view of what it looks like cleaned up. Detroit Durafram thermostatic expansion valve. Detroit Lubricator Company. Now, that has date A411 on there. I'm really not sure how to interpret that. But to give you an idea of the era this came from, methyl chloride. So this was for a methyl chloride system, which that was replaced by Freon in the late 30s. So it's definitely an early one. Looks to be complete. A friend of mine took this out of an old soft drink cooler that somebody had removed most of the cooling system from, but this was still stuck in the cabinet. Your superheat adjustment will be underneath this cap, I believe. Put a little PB Blaster on that, see if I can get that cap off of there. I'm sure at some point long ago, somebody probably made a superheat adjustment on this, and then it probably operated for no telling how long without any trouble. So we're going to go back behind them and check their adjustment. Looking there, it's not corroded. Everything looks pretty nice. Just a little dusty in there. So if you were having trouble with it freezing back to the compressor, or having too much superheat, either way you could adjust this stem and adjust the tension on the expansion valve. Changes the balance between the temperature function on the power head versus the pressure function. And then of course you torque that down to seal it so there won't be seepage around the stem. So old Detroit Lubricator methyl chloride expansion valve. And then this, I don't know how old this really is, but it's well made, it's real heavy. It's an Ansel refrigerant dryer. I came to find out that it's got a replaceable cartridge that you can take off of here. And the desiccant is down inside below that little mesh screen. And this head fits on there, and it's got, looks like some kind of rubber coated seal, almost like a Dowdy seal. That's heavy, that's solid brass. This came off of a 1940s Coca-Cola cooler, Kelvinator Coca-Cola cooler, that was brought here for repairs, and this was on it. A line had been broken, so I know that's saturated. The next thing, I got a new old stock relay overload combination. This is not that old, but now the company Supco, or Sealed Unit Parts Company, sells something like this. It looks entirely different, but functionality is almost the same. I don't know when this was made, but it's not made in China, so that gives you some idea of the age of it. Probably a perfectly good part. And then the next thing I got was a start kit, new old stock. Got a GE Mars relay, potential relay. Made in Mexico, not made in China or over Asia. And that same start kit came with a brand new Mallory capacitor, made in USA. Never even been used once. This relay, I'm gonna open it up, take a peek at the inside of it. Should be brand new. Yep, it is. So, to set the voltage where it picks up and turns off the start capacitor, you adjust this little cam here, and the closer that is, the less clearance it has, the lower the pickup voltage. So by turning that little white cam, you can adjust the pickup voltage within a certain range. A tiny little Allen key will fit in there. You buy this down at the supply house, they'll try to get about $60 for it, just the relay, but I think I paid $10 for the capacitor, the relay, and the capacitor clamp. So the next thing here, it's another even earlier expansion valve. American Thermostatic Expansion Valve, another Detroit Lubricator Company product. This one, the superheat adjustment is by adjusting the position of this cap. You see it's closing up right here. And I can back it off to a certain degree, it'll reach a stop. There's a little pin in it right there that stops it. Now this one, it was thermostatic, but the sensing line is broken off right there. Somebody probably cut it because they didn't know what they were doing. I don't know what's inside here, so we'll take it apart and see how it's made. Start again with the PB Blaster on all the bottom of these screws. And hopefully it'll come apart non-destructively. So I put it in the vise over there and I loosened all the fittings and stuff. So this will be the liquid line inlet. You can see there's a little screen right there. Keep any debris from getting into the works and damaging it. I think there's a seal that's stuck on there. I'm going to leave that. Looks like down in there there's a plug with a slot. Maybe that might unscrew. I don't really know. But this one, I hear a spring. So there's the needle valve. You see right there, that's what would actually meter the refrigerant through. The spring and the little damper thing for it. You can see that's an adjustment screw. So I guess you can set the depth of that so that I guess when it's fully open, it limits the capacity of the system, probably, just taking a wag at it. Then the top of it will take off here. I had already, like I said, I went to the vise and I loosened all the hardware so it would come apart easily. I don't know how old this is, but being that it's solid brass and built like it is, I'm sure it's older than the first one we looked at. I have a mid-1930s refrigerator built by Spartan. It has an expansion valve very similar to this in it, this original to it, from the 30s. So I think this one's probably 30s vintage. And that other one in that Spartan still works. So that's interesting. That's a Bakelite. The rod that actuates. I'm going to put some air pressure on that, see if it moves. So if I put the air to that, it blows through there. So apparently, whatever mechanism is in here is ruptured, and it's just allowing the air to flow through. So that probably is why it was taken out of service. If we look down in here, there's another bellows. Don't know how that one would come out of there. Push up on it on the linkage. See if I can get it to come out. Maybe not. It's been in there a long time. You can see a little fork in there, moves with the pressure on that. Oops. So I wonder if I can get this pin out and take this cap all the way off of there. All right, I took the pin out. Let's see if this will come all the way off of there. There we go. Another bellows. That one has a swivel function because this cap is used to adjust the spring tension on it. So if I straighten that little sensing line out, it ought to come out of there. See if I can straighten it out. I know this bellows is already broken, so I'm not real worried about it. There we go. So there's the bellows. Put a little bit of air on it, see if I can find the hole in it. Oh, no need to look far. It's a huge split right there. So I would say that was definitely the failure point that caused this to be taken out of service. If I could get another bellows just like that, same effective diameter, it would be pretty easy to put it back together and make it work again. Be no different than rebuilding these thermostats that I rebuild for the old Coke machines and fridges. So that goes on there. And then we'll try again to get this out, see if I can get it out of there, because I'd like to show all the works. But I have a feeling it may be soldered in on this top ring, so I'm not gonna take a risk and tear it up and destroy it. Because even though this isn't working, it's kind of a neat artifact. Put it all back together. This was on eBay a long time ago. They had a description of it like a steampunk relic, industrial relic or something. And I made an offer on it, and I told them that this stem was broken off. And because that was broken off, it was damaged and not a complete item. And I think I got it for something like $5 plus shipping. So, for just an interesting knickknack to look at, because it's cool and old and brass, I think I did okay. I'll put the needle valve back into the casing there. Push that spring back down. And then the little filter screen goes back in. Like that. Okay, that's the Detroit Lubricator thermostatic expansion valve, older style. And next thing, this is a really interesting, neat little piece. The Norge Rollator in a small model, probably a salesman sample. Really cute. And that's really a representation of really how the compressor's made. They really do look like that. You even got the curved spokes of the flywheel on the back. That Rollator name, this was invented by a man whose last name was Roloff. So that's where they get the name from. And you can see the cavity starts here and progresses all the way around the outside of the roller. And then it's divided by the little vane, the number one part that slides in and out, separate the suction and discharge. I have an actual real Norge Rollator unit here too. So this is an actual Norge refrigerator from the 30s. And there's your picture of the Rollator system ingrained into the porcelain shown on there, and a little sample for it. And then the machine itself is down here. Excuse the spider webs. So that's the actual Rollator pump rear of it, and the flywheel's down on the other end.
So the mini tour and the real thing side by side.
So last but not least, we have a pocket probe pyrometer, 0 to 250 Fahrenheit. This was given to me by a friend. He saw it at an antique shop. It looks like it's never been used. Got the instructions. Nice little case it's in. Got an instruction sheet in the top of it. Supposed to be 1% accurate. And you can look, the sensing tip, you can actually see the thermocouple junction on it right there. It's super thin, flexible material. And it's got like an RCA plug that goes in here. And then any temperature change, it'll measure it. You see the temperature going up there? Take it off my hand, it'll slowly go back down. Interesting thing about this, because it is truly a thermocouple, it is self-powered. So the current that runs the meter is generated by the heat. When you touch this right here, it actually is generating a small amount of electricity that goes through the meter movement and moves the probe, or moves the pointer. I hope that shows up how intricate that little tip is on there. But this was probably a kind of an expensive instrument when it was new. I really expect it was. This is ceramic. Got a jacketed cable in that little sensing tip on there. It's quite nice made. I'm going to get a hotter heat source to check it and see how it does with warmer temperatures. All right, I've got the big 100-watt GE soldering iron plugged in. Let's measure the temperature of the side of it. There's 100. One 50. And again, I just plugged the soldering iron in just a few seconds before I started the video. So it's definitely not fully heated up. You see it slowly climbing? We'll put it out here on a flatter surface. You might get a little better response. I got a good contact there. If I get back toward the tail part of it, it's even hotter. I don't want to send it over range, so I'll stop right there. Let that cool off. Interesting little piece of kit. Yeah, I hope everybody enjoyed seeing these knickknacks and trinkets and little historical pieces here. I just enjoy this kind of stuff. Love finding it, looking at it, sharing it, thinking about the people that used to, you know, this was their everyday work, their everyday life. These kind of things is what, you know, made the country run. And this is what they worked on every day. They'd go troubleshoot this and know exactly how it's supposed to feel and act, and seen 1,000 of them. And you know, today it's just a curiosity thing, but I like to think about those old days when it was common. And I hope everybody's enjoyed seeing this, and I'll try to do another video like this when I get some more stuff that's worth showing. Thanks for watching.